Evening and welcome everybody to this space, to our April Benedictine conversation. My name is Dawn Carrillo and I am the director of the Center for Spirituality and Enrichment, which is a ministry of the Sisters of Saint Scholastica here in Duluth. And I will be your host for this evening. And so I welcome you all. What we will do this evening is we'll have some conversation between myself and our two wonderful guests that we have for you this evening. And then we'll have some Q&A through the chat function, or you can also raise your hand. This is a webinar, so we are recording it and it'll go on our archive page on our Center for Spirituality and Enrichment website. So I would like to introduce to you our two guests for this evening. First, I would like to start with the one who's coming from furthest away, Sister Michelle Lallier, who is a Franciscan sister of Little Falls, Minnesota. Sister Michelle grew up on a farm and was introduced to St. Francis when she was in college. She lives in the Franciscan Welcoming House in St. Cloud, where she is very passionately spreading the gospel through her embrace of the Franciscan tradition and values. Just recently, I am so pleased to tell you all that she started this wonderful podcast called Engaging Franciscan Wisdom. I met Sister Michelle years ago when I lived in Little Falls, and she was working with a group of young people that my daughter was a part of. And since then, I've had the joy of knowing her as a colleague, as a wise spiritual thinker, and a dear friend. So Sister Michelle, I just want to welcome you to this space. Thank you so much for being here with us tonight.
Thank you. And I'm delighted to be here with my Benedictine brothers and sisters.
Wonderful. Our second guest tonight is Sister Teri Spinler, who is a Benedictine sister here at St. Scholastica Monastery. Also raised on a farm, so I'm hearing some common themes here in southern Minnesota. Sister Teri served as a teacher years ago and spent 3 years in Chile teaching, doing some very interesting things there. When she came back, she got a degree and served as a registered nurse, and she's worked as a massage therapist and has done retreat ministry. And now she's caring for the grounds here at the monastery in Duluth and at our other location in Duluth called McCabe Renewal Center. And so if you ever wonder why the grounds are so spectacular, with her beautiful eye and care, she's the one. I've had the delight of getting to know Sister Teri these 3.5 years since I've been here in Duluth, and I am really awed at her passion for the Benedictine life, for her commitment to the earth and all of its inhabitants, spreading her arms wide to allow room for all. Last summer, she told me this wonderful story about this cherry tree that they have in their monastery gardens, which was loaded with cherries, just loaded, she said, and they were ripe and ready to go, but then stripped overnight of its contents by some chipmunks. And Sister Teri's response was, well, those little guys have to eat too. So thank you for being here, Sister Teri. We're delighted to have you here, to have both of you here. Thank you. So I'd like to start with an opening prayer. I'm going to share my screen with this prayer. I thought in honor of Earth Day, which is on Thursday, and also our guest, Sister Michelle, I'm going to use a prayer this evening that is attributed to Saint Francis of Assisi. And so I invite you to just take a moment and quiet yourselves and let the busy day be gone from your minds and your hearts and reflect on these beautiful words. All praise be yours, my Lord, through all that you have made. And first, my Lord, brother, son, who brings the day. How beautiful is he, how radiant in all his splendor. Of you, most high, he bears the likeness. All praise be yours, my Lord, through sister moon and stars. In the heavens you have made them bright and precious and fair. All praise be yours, my Lord, through brothers wind and air. All praise be yours, my Lord, through sister water, so useful, lowly, precious, and pure. All praise be yours, my Lord, through brother fire, through whom you brighten up the night. All praise be yours, my Lord, through sister earth, our mother, who feeds us and produces various fruits with colored flowers and herbs. Praise and bless my Lord, and give him thanks, and serve him with great humility. Amen.
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 So, as we begin this evening, I'm conscious that to do a conversation like this one, where we are thinking about the environment and the care for our sacred earth home, that we probably need to establish what our assumptions are about the state of the planet. All over the world, people are in various stages of belief, awareness, acknowledgments that there might even be a serious environmental problem. So I'm wondering if you could just speak for a moment about what you see. What are the things happening to our world, to the environment, that most trouble you? So either one of you can begin.
Well, I think I'll begin and just say what troubles me is just opening my eyes and opening my ears and looking at the violent weather patterns we're having, which are causing severe droughts, severe floods, which is leading to more people losing their land, not having food, so we're having more poverty. Also, that comes into more tension, more stress, which leads us almost into the thought of today, which we were all watching in regards to the trial of Chauvin. And I bring it up because 51 years ago, when we first began Earth Day, I learned that it really wasn't just about Earth Day, about cleaning the air, but it was begun by people that were into doing away with injustice, discrimination, racism. So Earth Day was really tied up with the whole thing that happened today, justice and racism. I just thought that was really fascinating. And here we are talking about this whole thing with violence and the violent storms and the violence amongst people.
Wow. Yeah. Thank you, Sister Teri. Mm-hmm. Shell, what would you add?
I'll pick up with that moment with the Chauvin case today as well. As we were watching and listening upstairs here at the house, I got a text from a dear friend in Nicaragua who was following the case. And I know that there's this sense of interconnectedness. Mm-hmm. The interconnectedness is related to species on the planet. It's related to weather patterns, as you noted, Teri. It's related to our being connected as human beings as well. And so one of the assumptions that I bring in that's the state of our interpersonal relationships, our internal lives, and our relationship with God or with whatever value system we may hold has an impact on how we relate to the planet. And so it's part of a fabric, a way of seeing, a view of how we interpret meaning in the world. And so care of the earth, what St. Francis calls in the canticle that you read, our sister, Mother Earth, that we're related. And how do we attend to, as the indigenous peoples would say, with all our relations? So that's one of the assumptions that I bring as a Franciscan, where St. Francis was known by perceiving the interconnectedness of all of creation through his own mystical, spiritual experience. He knew it in his person. The second thing I would say is that I've lived in Nicaragua. I've spent time in parts of Africa, been to Mexico and in some of our neighborhoods, and even where our mother house is, a very poor rural county, an urban or rural county, yes, that those who are economically poor are more likely to feel the weight of the impact of environmental degradation. So those of us who are more secure, we have running water, we have irrigation, we have deeper wells, we have some financial resources, family networks, will feel it less than those that are living in extremely vulnerable places, islands where the water is rising, mountaintops where there's, you know, slides in Central America, for example. So we are our brothers and sisters keeper is one of my assumptions and my experience, mm-hmm. and that extends to the care of the earth and mm-hmm. her creatures.
Yeah, thank you. Thank you both. Yeah, the interconnectedness of it all.
Ties it with Chief Seattle said many years ago about this whole web of life.
Yeah.
And I think that's such a perfect example when you think of a spider web and you see when it's really built, it is so strong. But if some of those strands get broken, it begins to weaken. And it's a perfect example of what's happening on our planet. The strands are broken and our planet is getting weaker and weaker from all the environment problems. So we have to get this built up again because we are all connected. Everything's connected.
Yeah. Okay, so that's, you know, a broad picture. I want to just turn into you personally now, and I'd like to hear from you what you're holding in your heart. What is really in your heart today? I know we've talked about the verdict with the Derek Chauvin trial, but when we think about our beloved Earth home and the ways that she is hurting, what is the one or two things that really sit in your heart?
For myself, I would say it's a partnering of grief and gratitude. And the gratitude part I'll start with is because of the resilience of plant life, animal life, human life, and our ability to adapt and to recover and to heal if given the conditions to do so. And secondly, the grief or sorrow is witnessing, you know, whether it's my grandfather's farm now churned up under little row houses down by the cities, whether it's visiting the site of a mudslide in Nicaragua, wherever it is that there are signs of distress on the planet, and some of it is human impacted, the burning of rainforests, those kinds of things. And so that's what I bring tonight, is a recognition of that coexistence in my heart.
Mm-hmm. Thank you. How about you, Sister Teri?
Yeah, I agree with you, Michelle, on that. There certainly is that grief or sadness, and I feel that same thing because of what I see around me. And I also am aware that many people are aware, but some people are aware, but they're ignoring it, really. They know it, but they won't acknowledge it. They go on living like everything's fine. Mm-hmm. And so that's a real sadness for me. But at the same time, you could say gratitude, but also hope. I see the hope in young people. I just even think of our college students who are very aware of the problems, and they're really working for sustainability and solar panels. I think there's a lot of hope in young people. So I thank God for that. So I have hope in our young people, because I do see sadness in what's happening around, and people just not acknowledging that there's something wrong. We can't go on living like this. Mm-hmm. So it's a tension between the two of sadness or grief and the hope that I have.
Mm-hmm. And I feel like this past year has really revealed some gaping wounds for raising awareness in a way that I haven't seen happen before. Have you noticed that?
I've seen the awareness of more violent storms, but I don't know if people have really become, are really recognizing that as climate change. I hear some of that, but I also hear a lot of denial yet, even though I see these more violent storms. So I'm not too sure if people are coming around to what's really happening.
Yeah.
And I would say that perhaps the pandemic has slowed certain things down and amplified other things. Mm-hmm. And so, you know, whether it's, as you noted, Teri, the young people such as Greta Thunberg, and how many young people protesting around pollution through lines being put through tribal lands or near water sources. There's a way in which, because we're so globally connected, we have the ability to see this interconnectedness around the globe. How many places are food insecure around the planet? And then you start looking at locations in Africa or the Middle East, or you know, in the inner cities, and that vulnerability, the food insecurity, is directly related to environmental degradation and the inability of, you know, equitable sharing of resources so that small farmers can actually make a living anymore wherever they are these days in the planet, especially if they're vulnerable to the shifts in the land and the weather patterns and things. So yeah, maybe this being slowed down offers us an opportunity to see more clearly, because we're not moving as rapidly. And as Jesus said, those who have the eyes to see will, and others simply aren't aware. They haven't made the connections. They aren't in relationship to those news sources or those peoples or those realities, and so simply don't know.
Michelle, what do you think? What do you think St. Francis would say if he was on this Zoom call with us here today?
Well, I chuckled. And so the first thing I thought of was my professor, Franciscan Brother Bill Short. And he stood in front of the class, this is out in San Francisco at the Franciscan School of Theology. And he said, I know you're all going to ask me, what would Francis do? What would Francis say? Let me tell you, Francis is dead. And that's my response. It's Jesus, in his physically presence amongst us, for those of us who are Christians, is dead. But his spirit, so Francis's spirit, Claire's spirit, those who followed this inspiration of how to live human and gospel values, their spirit lives. And so what would I say in that tradition? I think Francis, as I would feel with him, would probably be weeping. As he did at times, he would weep over the worm in the road that was crushed, or the lamb on the way to the market that would be slaughtered. He had a tremendous empathy, compassion capability. His heart was large enough. In fact, there's a saying from an early mystery play, a medieval mystery play. St. Francis is from 800 years ago, so the Middle Ages. And the phrase was in there, where one of his followers was showing whom he called Lady Poverty, because poverty of spirit, material poverty, is part of what he saw as a path to freedom, to follow in the footsteps of Jesus. And so one of the brothers said to Lady Poverty, brought her to the brow of a hill when she said, show me your cloister, which would be like the religious place where they would live their religious lives at that time. And he said, this lady the world is our cloister. And so for me, that ability that Francis had to see our interconnectedness, that we're all in the same prayer. We're all breaths of God. We're all invited to love without measure the one who loved us fully. And that love spills not only to our immediate family, not only to our God, but to all peoples and to all of creation. It is interconnected. So that's what I would bring.
Yeah, thank you. Sister Teri, what do you think about that?
I know
Benedict is dead. So what would you bring forth for words from the tradition? Yeah.
I think Francis and Benedict probably thought very much alike here.
Yeah.
But you took the words right out of my mouth, Michelle, because I was going to say if Benedict was here, he would weep also. If he saw what's happening, you know, because in his rule, everything is moderation. And if you really think about living in moderation, it's living simply, it's living what you need, not what you want. And if we really lived with just what we need, we would, and also his big thing is community, what you talked about, Michelle, we would be looking at community globally and looking at the needs of all the people, not what we want, but what our need is. And if everybody, if we could live community globally, letting people have what they need, we would really be, it would be different. And I think that's what Benedict expected of us, to really live moderately, simply, and in this community of sharing with all. I think that's what he would ask us to do today if he was here. Probably tell us to shape up, get with it.
You know, I wasn't going to bring this up, but I think it's right before I signed on to start this evening, I was reading an article in the New York Times about Elon Musk, and he just won this $2.9 billion contract to make the spaceship to shuttle people to the moon. And so I was reading an opinion thing about, well, why do people like Elon Musk and Jeff Bezos from Amazon want to get off the earth? You know, what is it that they, what are they, you know, and part of their thinking is to relieve the earth from the pressure of what we're doing now. And what hit me when I was reading it was, what would Francis say? Well, how would Francis and Benedict react to something like that? You know, I don't know if you have any thoughts about that. Responses.
I think that's running away. And I sometimes when I think about people want to go to space, that almost frightens me because they'll probably contaminate that area too. Another mess. I think need to stay right here and live life the way it's supposed to be lived. Mm-hmm. You know, if we can't live life properly here and in community and moderately and what we're called to do, then it's not going to happen on another planet either. So.
Yeah. And I think Francis would first of all be absolutely astounded and in complete wonder that this is even possible.
Right.
And would just recognize the ingenuity, the creativity that would make that possible. But a secondary part kind of to what you were saying, Teri, is his recognition that we're all who we are before God and no more. We're also no less in terms of humility, in terms of what he called minoritas, being minor, minoritas, is a certain, we are lesser than, we choose to not exert power over or power against, but we choose to be in a relationship of deep respect and honor. And so my hunch would be, if we're moving in those directions, what is our intention? What is our motivation? What is it that we are looking for? And if it's not in accord with simplicity and humility and a deep sense of honor and respect of all life, then maybe we should be doing our homework before as you said, Teri, moving on and exporting what has already destroyed here. So it's not that it's not that it's a bad thing. It's about the timing and the accountability to it.
Right. The right and the stated purpose for it. Yes. I'm reminded of the Franciscan theologian and scientist Ilia Delio, who has written extensively on this in terms of our use of technology. And she actually was a guest here in Duluth for us a couple of years ago. And one of the striking things she said, she showed a graph of the growth of technology, the exponential growth of technology. And she posed the question, what's it for? If it's for bettering our lives, and the problems we're facing on the planet, great. But if it's happening because of profit and greed, she speaks quite a bit about the interconnectedness of each cell of creation, each teeny little, they even discovered a new one recently called, a meon or something like that. But how do you respond to that? How do you think about that, that interconnectedness of us all?
Yeah, we're definitely all connected. You know, sometimes you read that, well, we're all just a ball of energy. Everything is. We're a bunch of molecules and atoms, and everything is. Trees, rocks, water. We're all molecules, you know, atoms, different types, but we are all energy. We're just mixed up a little differently. And also, we all came from dust and we're all going to go back to dust. So, you know, when you think of it's quite awesome when you think of that. Mm-hmm. We human beings are just a ball of energy. And we're also just a ball of dust. And we're going to go back to that dust, which mm-hmm. is really pretty awesome. Sometimes you hear people say we came from stardust, yeah. and so we will go back to stardust, which is so yeah. beautiful. I like yeah. that. Yeah. But yes, we are all connected. That dust is all connected, the molecules, the atoms, the energy. It's all one. Mm-hmm. I don't even know how to explain that, but I just see it all mixed up and we're all one.
Yeah. I think an entry point to that from a Franciscan perspective would be matter matters. Mm. And the incarnation is central. Yeah. By that meaning the becoming human, the revelation of God as a human being. St. Bonaventure would say, as an early Franciscan, that creation was God's first book. The first book about mm-hmm. God was creation. Mm-hmm. And some people could recognize it, maybe the shepherds under the stars and people that lived on the land, but many didn't. And then God sent the prophets. There was another book of revelation about God, and some got it and their hearts were changed. And then, well, as Jesus tells us, then the Father sent his Son, right? This, I'm thinking of one of the parables, and Jesus says that. And some got it and others didn't, mm-hmm. that we're all connected through time. And that in time, some perceive that interconnectedness, that web of life, and others don't. And that those of us who do have a responsibility to live in accord with what is revealed to us, what our experience is, and that witnesses an alternative way. I think of the old saying, they'll know you're Christians by your love. Well, what is the nature of love? It's relationship. And it's like the trinity of self-giving, overflowing love. And we participate in that, those of us who call ourselves Christians, in that overflowing love that would flow not only, again, to family of origin and co-workers and prophet, but to neighbors down the street and neighbors down the hemisphere and neighbors in the other sets of species, that we are one, as you said. And okay. Jesus prayed that all may be one. So with Francis's intuition that all are brothers and sisters, that includes creation, not only the mm-hmm. human part of the family. We're all family. So.
Wow. You know, I think we would all probably recognize that there's a part of our Christian tradition and heritage that we can still see operative today that would say that we don't have to concern ourselves with these issues. Our goal is heaven out there. This is all temporary. We don't have to really worry about it, that God will take care of it. What our job is to, I mean, some go as far as saying, subdue the earth and use it as we need it. And then God's going to take care of the earth. We're just heaven bound anyway. I'm wondering if you could speak a little about this line of thinking. Maybe we could start with Sister Teri from a Benedictine point of view.
From a Benedictine point of view, well, you know, I'm going to jump over here for a minute. I think Benedict used scripture basically in much scripture in his rule. And I think when I think of what he put in the rule as basically scripture, when you go back and talk about subduing the earth and so on, in that first creation story, there's two creation stories. And if we lived the second one, we would be living the way Benedict wanted us to live. Because in my translation, it says, you know, God created the human beings, and then they cultivated the earth, and they guarded and cared for the earth. And I think that's what Benedict would ask us to do and does ask us to do, because he also talks about the sacredness, that we are to treat everything in creation as sacred. Mm-hmm. And that is really caring for the earth, really is what we're expected to do. And I think that's what he expected us to do, is to look at everything as sacred, to care for the earth. And we're put here to help bring this planet, this earth, all of our lives to fulfillment. And we're here for a purpose. We're not just put here and then we say, well, God will take care of everything. No, God put us here to care for the earth, to guard the earth, and to bring things to fruition, to fullness.
Mm-hmm. Co-create. So, yeah. Co-create, yeah.
Yeah, co-create, exactly, right on.
Thank you, yeah.
So that was
Michelle, what would you add?
Yeah, I think that last point there of being here to co-create, that putting ourselves in the larger context rather than kind of an anthropocentric, human-centered, you know, everything's here for me to exploit, whether it's for profit or because I earned it or because I deserve it or because I can do it by might, that putting it in the broader context, we are very recent on the scene of creation as human beings. And how Saint Francis had the understanding that everything was gift, all is gift. And so beauty, when he and the friars would live in these little huts along the way, they would always cultivate a little vegetable garden to help them eat. And a part of it always had to have flowers for beauty. Mm-hmm. And so I'll share a passage at the end of the evening on beauty, but to me, how would I respond would be invite each person to be connected to nature, connect with being in a park or at the lake or hiking and camping out on some, you know, remote area. Like I think of the Boundary Waters. I brought groups of young adults up there. Let nature teach us and let nature reveal to us our interconnectedness. For some who live in urban environments, it may be the cat or the dog or the creature that is in their care, but that too teaches us about mutuality of care. And so connecting with beauty, with nature, with others, that as we nourish our own souls, the soil of our own lives, we have more generosity of spirit or energy or inspiration to care for others. But if we're just hanging on, if we're riddled with anxiety and we're overwhelmed with responsibility and we're at survival because of financial or health concerns, safety concerns, it's very hard to have the spaciousness for caring for the earth. Mm-hmm. And so those of us who do have more ability to have that flexibility and spaciousness to do the care have more responsibility.
Yeah, yeah.
Why some people in a very rural area would be cutting down the trees so they can cook their food. And others are cutting down the trees to put more cattle out and destroy the biodiversity of that area and leave it devastated so that we can expend however what percent more it is of energy to cultivate a pound of beef than how many pounds of vegetables. So I think it gets to some of the practical, which we'll get to a little bit later.
Well, and I think this brings us to the next question I wanted to explore with you, and that is the impact on our spiritual selves that environmental degradation, lack of care for creation, which we have said over and over is connected to lack of care for one another. So could you speak a little bit about how you see that connection? You did just a minute ago, Michelle, you talked about particularly people in circumstances where they are constrained in different ways, and that impacts the spiritual self anyway. But what happens inside us as we go about destroying our world?
Well, I'll pick up. To me, as I said earlier, that destructive attitude isn't just about the world. It's destroying, as you kind of alluded to, our inner selves and our fabrics of relationships. When I lived in Nicaragua for 5 years, it was after a moderate person had been elected. There had been a dictator and then a revolutionary government. And then after some years of a U.S. embargo, there was a moderate-backed person that was elected. And in the years I was there, which was five, I watched the social fabric of that culture disintegrate. And in that, watching people devolve further into survival. And again, at survival, we do what we have to do to survive. Mm-hmm. So the more of us that are at a survival level due to trauma, I mean, I think of the communities of color in our country, many are deeply traumatized for generations, and we're seeing what was invisible to some now lifted up more visibly. How are we our brothers and sisters, how do we care for our brothers and sisters and allow ourselves to be changed by that and learn how is it we're unconsciously participating in that? That's also true environmentally. Mm-hmm. We get kind of callous to it, or we're unconscious of it. And so the impact on our spirits, I think one is grief. Again, I'm going to return to that. There's a low grade of depression, grief, discouragement, overwhelm, paralysis that can come if we're disconnected from social trust, from beauty, from relatedness in not only to ourself and maybe our God and our immediate circle of loved ones, but the larger social fabric of the human family and then the family of creation, that it disturbs the well-being of our soul, and we have a harder time seeing more accurately because of that.
Yeah, which just perpetuates it. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Sister Teri, what would you add there?
It was really well said, you know, how it does affect us that way. We can get discouraged, or we can experience that grief. But I love the word beauty. If we take time to see the beauty, it makes all the difference in the world. And I think that's one thing that helps me a great deal. Plants help me a lot. I see beauty in plants, or I see beauty in working in the dirt or admiring trees. So even though I can get down or observe what's happening, and it does seem very overwhelming at times, where does one begin with it all? So big. But to turn to the beauty and to turn to the little things in creation can make such a difference, can really bring me up in a day if I can get to that point. But it is a big mammoth thing to deal with. It can become almost too big until we start looking at little things to pull us through the day. And I think the other thing is, turning to prayer. I have to say prayer is most important for me, because it's like really work at trying to send, praying for people that are trying to make changes, praying for people that need to change, or also thinking of this as really positive energy going out, trying not to be negative because that really affects the world too. Mm-hmm. So getting that positive energy out there and praying for the people that are really working hard to make changes. You know, sometimes these changes are too big or too far away, don't really know what to do, but prayer is so powerful that for me, that's one way I can make a difference, at least to get at it at that. And the other thing is, I think I find encouraging people that are working on change. And again, I go back to students, you know, if they're trying to make a change, you know, give them encouragement and say, that's the way to go. I support you the whole way. So supporting, you know, I can't really do it, I'll support somebody that can do it, or in that way. So I guess that's what I would see where I could fit in that way.
It's interesting talking about prayer. And when we put that together with this notion of our interconnectedness and the energy that we are, that is the power of prayer, right? Mm-hmm. Yeah. I'm going to open it now to our participants out there to send in some comments. We'd love your questions. And if you would like to raise your hand and say something, go ahead and do that. There should be a little raise hand function at the bottom of the screen. We do have a comment from Warren. He says, "We are glad for your witness, sisters, and for your wisdom." Amen. Dr. Peter Lee says, "This is the discussion board topic that I gave my undergraduate students this week. I would welcome your response. Thank you." Quote, "In this week's module, we have looked at liberation and the quest for racial equality. Suggest similar cases of inequality and injustice today, and suggest positive ways that this can be addressed." End quote. So, liberation and the quest for racial equality, cases you might have seen of inequality and injustice today, and to suggest positive ways that this could be addressed.
Well, I'll give you one example that I became aware of in the last couple of months, because I grew up on a little farm north of the Twin Cities, 70 some acres. My dad and my mom both worked outside of the house. They really believed and wanted us kids to grow up on farms, because both of them did. And I just learned recently, I just have never had exposure to this, that in Minnesota, there have been inequitable access to resources for Black farmers compared to white farmers. And this has been a generational reality of who gets access to the loans, who gets responses from offices, and who doesn't. And so one of the ways that we look at inequality is a voice at the table. And so one of the questions I would bring in terms of care of the earth is, who's not at the table that ought to have a voice? And I think of two, three years ago, Pope Francis had a synod in the Amazon trying to lift the voices of what was happening environmentally there. Was a huge part of that, wasn't the whole thing. And for those of us living in the Northern Hemisphere, you know, that's pretty removed from us. So how do we become aware, take seriously what we're hearing, and respond? Prayer is one of those responses, but so is writing legislators. Mm-hmm. So is changing our own lifestyle, what I think in both our Benedictine and Franciscan traditions we call conversion, conversion of life, conversion of heart, where we turn to God, we turn to neighbor. And our neighbor, again, may be the care of the earth, our sisters and brothers in creation, as well as our sisters and brothers in the human family.
And in that turning toward God, we're adjusting our sight.
Yes.
So that we can become aware and see. Teri, is there anything you would add to that?
It's a very good question, but I need some more time to think about that one. But you gave a good answer, Michelle. That was really good.
Yeah, I'll say one thing to bring a voice from Nicaragua. Went just in what you were saying, Dawn, that Raul was teaching a little workshop in Managua. I'll say it in Spanish first for those who are Spanish persons here, Spanish speaking. He said, un punto de vista es solo eso, la vista de un punto. So he said, one's point of view is just that, the view from one point. Mm. And so if we see the world in a certain way, we've been conditioned, our family, our cultural group, our church or religious tradition, our social media contacts, get out of the comfort zone and go somewhere or connect with someone or relate with an organization that has a very different point of view and engage and be transformed mm-hmm. and be a part of transformation. So I think it's getting out of our bubbles and comfort zones and actually engaging in some of the beautiful diversity and the challenging differences that are in our midst, and there, under the guidance of the Spirit, seeking where are we one and how do we move towards that?
Yeah. Well, and this brings us right to the next thing I wanted to explore, and that is we talk about seeing or lack thereof, lack of seeing. I think a lot of us here tonight feel a deep sense of urgency about this. Human beings are slow to respond very often, right? And some, as we've talked about, are just struggling to survive themselves and don't have that mental space to give to this issue. So we've talked a little about what's needed to change this, to raise awareness. Are there other things you would add? What do you think, Teri?
Well, as I said before, sometimes the things are so big, we can't do it, but we sure can do things ourselves. The littlest thing makes a big difference, whatever we do, whether we stop pesticides on our grounds or whether we don't waste water, whether we don't use plastic bags. I mean, there's a lot of things we can do individually. They don't seem like much, but if one person does it and can encourage other people to do it, it makes a difference in that connection, in that web of life. So along with what we've talked about, you can write letters, you can encourage people, you can do the small things yourself. I think that's what I have to say, because it's sometimes, as we were saying, it gets so big. But I like what you said, Michelle, about getting out of where we are and moving into a different place and experience what other people are experiencing. And sometimes that's to go and work in a poor area, right in our own city, and get our eyes open to what these people are going through. Because we can live in our comfortable place and not realize truly what people are experiencing, unless we take ourselves out of this comfortable area and go and experience what other people are experiencing that don't have what we have. Mm-hmm. So I think that is another important thing to help move us to see something different, and then talk about it with other people, to get that out there and encourage other people to come with us to go do that. Mm-hmm. Small things, but they can add to making a change. Mm-hmm.
Thank you.
Yeah, and I think what I would add to that is building on what you just last said of connecting with others. We can't do it alone. And so relationships, community, organizations, there are so many amazing organizations dedicated to supporting movement for change in a sustainable way on our planet. And do some Google researching, ask around, try out different things and see what fits for where one's life energy is. Because we each have, I had a mentor, her name was Angelus Arian, and she said, every one of us is created by virtue of our personality, the family and the culture we're born into, the experiences that have made us who we are. It's the perfect architecture to carry out our life dream. And so what is our dream? What have we been put on the planet for? And getting back at how are we tuned in, plugged in through prayer, through community, through beauty, through relationship that nourishes us, because of our own energy, we will fall flat and burn out and get discouraged and callous and cynical, or just stop. But keeping connected and engaged and the flow of spirit amongst us builds and strengthens and encourages. I saw that over and over again in the family and legal teams speaking after Chauvin's trial. The building of community, the strengthening for the journey that is not done, but has been encouraged to stay in for another step. And that's what we can be for each other if we're connected.
I'm thinking of one woman's words. She fell to her knees when she heard the verdict, and she said, she was in tears, and she said, "We matter. We really matter." Yeah. So I have one of my children whose name I will not say, who says, "You know what? I'm thinking about, you know, the small things like we've been talking about, and practical things people can do in their own personal lives, you know, in their own homes." I think about at the monastery, Sister Teri and Sister Lois are very good about saving water to use to water the plants, you know. And what a lesson that is for all of us that work there. So anyway, this one of my children said, "Do you realize that it takes more resources to recycle than it does to just make new stuff? What's, you know?" And yes, he's feeling some desperation about it. Like, you know, what are we supposed to do? Does it even matter? Which I think sometimes young people can go there too. So, What do you say to someone who says that to you? What do you say, Teri?
Well, maybe if she should just say the three R's. Reduce, okay? Reduce things. And then reuse things. Then recycle. But if we reduce the use of things, again, what we need, not what we want. That would make a big difference right there. And then reuse it. We can reuse lots of things, but we're kind of in a consumerism society right now. So it's hard to find things we can reuse, but we can reuse a lot of things if we want to. Right. And then finally recycle. I guess I would try to work with the three R's with somebody like that when they're talking about it takes too much energy to recycle. Well, then reduce what you need.
which he does. Yeah. Okay. That's a great answer. Thank you. The three R's. How about you, Michelle?
Again, I think if we're individual persons trying to respond to a global issue, it's just overwhelming. And I do think every small bit makes a difference. I'll give you an example. A friend of mine joined a monastery in the Redwoods, Carmelite monastery for 3 years. And she discerned out, now she's a happy mom and married. But when she lived in that monastery, they lived 100% sustainably. They did not even waste a toothpick. There was no garbage in this monastery, none. They lived in the woods, they lived off the woods, and that was like, wow, it's possible that we can simplify our lives. So there really is among young people a hunger for community and meaning, and, you know, purposeful life. And so I would really encourage young people, well, if I lived intentionally, who would I want to live with and how would I want to live? And go do it. Have an experiment of intentional intergenerational community. Men, women, married, single, intergenerational, yeah. But do honor your dream, and it makes a difference. Whatever little bit we can do is part of a bigger picture of choosing life. And it's a movement, and we can be part, small though it may be, of a larger movement. When we find like-minded, like-hearted people, we gather our resources, it can make a more substantial impact. But we start right in our own little life, in our own little circle, and check in with our heart and honor what we hear in choosing life.
Another great answer. Thank you. Mm-hmm. Well, I'm aware our time is almost at its end. And so I just want to thank everyone. Thank you, Sister Teri, for being with us tonight. Thank you, Sister Michelle, for being here. It's been a wonderful, rich conversation that just like you were talking, Michelle, about it's important to speak with others. And you did too, Teri, not just for ourselves, but to take it out to the community and come together with like-minded people. And so I'm grateful for your being here. Thank you. I want to let everyone know, we have one comment from Dr. Peter. Thank you so much. This has been most enlightening and a blessing. Thank you for an inspiring conversation from Jim. Jane says, thank you, Sister Teri and Michelle, for your insights. I'd like to say, oh, and Greg Spofford says, thank you for your encouragement to connect with the spirit within each other. So true. Very true. I'd like to hear just some final words from each of you. What would you like to leave us with tonight? And I'm going to ask you, Sister Teri, to start us out.
I think I would just sort of end with mentioning the first word that Benedict says in his rule. And if we really and truly listen with the ear of our heart and listen to the earth, listen to the water, listen to the trees, listen to the animals, listen. They're telling us things. And we not only listen to people, but listen to what's around us. We're being told things. We just have to listen.
Yeah.
So listen with the ear of your heart to the everything around us, not only people. The other thing I think is to keep in mind that web that we are all connected, and we have to keep that web strong. So whatever we do to another person or another creature or to the water or the air, we either build that web and keep it strong, or we are weakening that web. We have all that power within us to keep that web strong, and we must keep it strong. Those are two things I think. And then I really think it's to continue to pray. We have to pray. There's a power in prayer. And like Julian of Norwich, it's always encouraging for me to say her words, all will be well. All will be well. All matter of things will be well. That's Julian of Norwich.
Thank you. It's beautiful. Thank you. Sister Michelle.
Yeah, I'm happy for the question. And I would just share a few little lines from St. Francis and then a comment about it. This comes from Chelano, who's the first biographer of St. Francis 800 years ago. And he wrote, in art, Francis praises the artist, big A. Whatever he discovers in creatures, he guides to the creator. He rejoices in all the works of the Lord's hands, and through their delightful display, he gazes upon their life-giving reason and cause. In beautiful things, he discerns beauty, big B, itself. So in art, Francis praises the artist. In beautiful things, he discerns beauty itself. What I would encourage each of us is, let us pray, let us see, let us care and love, and let us put our love into action.
Thank you. Beautiful. Thank you.